Good morning. It's Wednesday, July the 8th, and this is The Drill. Thank you very much. I'm Ron, your host and the only true conservative in the United States today. My podcast is short, approximately 5 to 10 minutes long, because shorter podcasts are easier to download and listen to. I've been listening to conservative talk radio since 1989. I've grown up in a socialist household, and I've learned the tricks of socialism. My podcast is made available through Spreaker and can be heard on iTunes, Spotify, Google, and YouTube. Today, what can I do? Quote of the day: positive news, the 70s, and all that when I come back. Thank you. What can I do? Claim your victories. Too many times a conservative will be engaged in a debate with a lefty, win the argument, and then stand around waiting for the lefty to acknowledge the win. The left won't do this. As soon as you score the victory, say goodbye and walk away. You do not understand. They will tell you that you do not understand. The right answer to that arbitrary question is you do not understand. Insist that they are the one that does not understand, and then say goodbye and walk away. Why do we do this? Because the left is acting in bad faith. How do we know with certainty that they are acting in bad faith? Because they are refusing to accept responsibility and are instead placing blame. If they were acting in good faith, they would say the following: I obviously misstated my position. Let me rephrase and make myself clear. They accuse you of misunderstanding not because they have something important to say, but instead are using this accusation as a tool to shut you up. Remember, not what are they saying, but what are they doing. Since they are not acting in good faith, there's no reason to take what they say at face value. You just need to demonstrate to the left that you are not going to obey orders and then claim your victory. Next up, quote of the day. Thank you. The quote of the day comes from dailyscripture.net. Lord Jesus, you love each of us individually with a unique and personal love. Touch my life with your saving power. Heal and restore me to fullness of life. Help me to give wholly of myself in loving service to others. Amen. Up next, good news. Thank you. From the GOP website, June's jobs report proves all Americans win in President Trump's economy. Black Americans, 404,000 jobs added, and unemployment dropped by 1.4%. Hispanic Americans, 1.47 million jobs added, and unemployment dropped 3.1%. Asian Americans, 1.47 million jobs added, and unemployment dropped 1.2%. Up next, integration versus diversity. Thank you. Picking up where it left off in the book titled The 70s. In my last podcast, we covered the beginnings of the change from integration to diversity and how the musical group Sly and the Family Stone reflected those changes. And now we're going to go ahead and continue with all of the different elements in our society and back in the 70s that contributed to that change. If I can find this here. There it is. Okay. It's called The 70s, The Great Shift in American Culture, Pop Society, and Politics by Bruce Shulman. Sly and the Family Stone abandoned the integrationist ideal with less humor and more pain. In 1971, Sly and the Family released There's a Riot Going On, an album that issued a grim new report on the state of the nation. The album seemed to reconsider all of the earlier optimistic tunes, to recall them to the factory. Riot's lyrics focused on betrayal, failure, oppression, on being trapped, the music, lacking the raucous celebratory quality of Sly's earlier records, offered just as much a reversal as the lyrics. The title track, There's a Riot Going On, was blank. An old hit. Thank you for letting me be myself again, reappeared transmogrified. No longer an expression of gratitude for an American freedom, it became thank you for talking to me, Africa. A Thanksgiving prayer for the strength to stop running from the pistol-packing devil, stand your ground, and wrestle him to the ground. Riot offered a black musician's anguished rejection of a nation that limited his freedom in palpable and disturbing ways. There's a Riot Going On was an album that Sly and the Family's audience, particularly its white listeners, did not want to hear. To a large extent, African Americans were rejecting the integrationist ideal, abandoning the hope of joining a single American community, and actively shaping its destiny. Instead, they increasingly saw themselves as a separate nation within a nation, with distinct needs and values. Nor were blacks the only Americans to reject integration as an assimilist nightmare, assimilationist. Chicanos, Indians, Asian Americans, even white ethnics and the elderly would follow suit. From power to cultural nationalism. The critique of integration began with the emergence of the Black Power movement in the mid-1960s. Militant black nationalism received its most potent denunciation from Malcolm X, a former street hustler and convict who, in prison, converted to the Nation of Islam and became the minister of nations of the nation's New York City mosque. Born Malcolm Little, the militant leader scorned integration, rejected nonviolence in favor of self-defense by any means necessary, and urged pride in blackness. His message appealed most strongly to northern urban blacks who had not participated in the earlier civil rights struggles. They admired Malcolm's radicalism, his background, his audacious willingness to stand up to whites. But his teachings also caught on amongst younger civil rights activists in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, who became disillusioned with King's strategy of nonviolence. The lie down before your oppressor philosophy, one young militant declared, is now a treadmill upon which the Negro is running fast, but getting nowhere fast. Black power, of course, meant different things to different people, but its central message was the assertion of political power. Defining black power in 1967, James Boggs insisted that the movement must concentrate on the issue of political power, refusing to redefine and explain away black power as black everything except black political power. In October 1966, Bobby Seale and Huey P. Newton formed the Black Panther Party in Oakland, California. Merging black nationalism with Marxist-Leninist doctrine, the party described black ghettos as exploited colonies of the United States trapped within its borders. The party called itself a revolutionary vanguard that would lead the urban masses against their oppressors, first targeting the military arm of our oppressors, the police, and the criminal justice system. It recruited heavily among ex-convicts and prison inmates and engaged in several bloody confrontations with police, including a 1967 fray that left one officer dead and a wounded Huey Newton in custody. Even the black arts movement, a self-consciously aesthetic endeavor, stressed political power. The movement's leader, poet, and dramatist, Amiri Baraka, called for a socially powerful, politically functional arm of black expression. Quote, "We want poems that kill," unquote, Baraka wrote in his 1968 poem, Black Art. "We want," quote, "assassin poems, poems that shoot guns, poems that wrestle cops into alleys and take their weapons, leaving them dead with tongues pulled out and sent to Ireland," unquote. What distinguished these lethal stories, poems, and plays? They exploded in the mind of the reader or audience, shocking the oppressors, but most important, shocking the oppressed so that they would acquiesce no longer in their own oppression, cease to misunderstand, and even participate in their own degradation. Art was a vehicle to concentrate economic or It was a vehicle to concrete economic and political power. Over the course of a decade, the cultural element of black power gradually supplanted the political as the movement's basic thrust. In the 1970s, many activists concluded that black culture was black power, that an assertion of power lay inherent in maintaining and expressing a distinctive culture through clothing, music, hairstyle, literature, cuisine, and the arts. For the dispossessed, denied access to wealth and political institutions, cultural nationalism enhanced group autonomy and diminished black dependence on white society. Black culture staked out a sphere of activity relatively free from white influence and domination. It also advanced a positive black-defined black identity that rejected white stereotypes. Even the Black Panther Party gradually stressed cultural development and community control over armed revolution. The Panthers ran free breakfast and health care programs in black neighborhoods, passed out shoes and clothing to the needy, and offered screening for sickle cell anemia. It distributed groceries and opened liberation schools, offering courses in Afro-American history and culture. While many of the programs originated as efforts to win the support of the black masses in preparation for the inevitable revolution, developing community pride and institutions soon became an end in itself. By the mid-70s, this militant, exclusionary form of black power would occupy an influential place in American public discourse, and the same brand of cultural nationalism began to develop among other racial minorities. Just as Stokely Carmichael and the Black Panther Party represented a younger, angrier generation than that of Martin Luther King Jr., and Whitney Young and other established civil rights leaders, so a new cohort arose within other minority communities. These young activists also rejected integration and despised assimilation. In Chicano Manifesto, Armando Rendon renounced the success he had acquired in the white man's world and denounced the older generation, the Mexican-American businessmen, politicians, and civic leaders who disclaimed their heritage, quote, and will have nothing to do with La Causa, unquote. Unlike African-Americans who had vainly sought integration into inequality within, quote, Anglo-dominated world, and, quote, only recently sought anew a black identity and cultural separateness, unquote, the Chicano movement and those of American Indians and Asian Americans almost immediately advanced an anti-assimilationist, cultural nationalist agenda. In 1972, Rodolfo Acuna, founding chairman of the pioneering Chicano Studies program at California State University at Northridge, published Occupied America, the Chicano Struggle Toward Liberation. Acuna's book, one of the earliest academic studies of Mexican Americans, also offered the manifesto of a self-described activist academic, one who captured a wider mood by titling his final two chapters, Goodbye America. The 1960s, Acuna wrote, represented a decade of both awareness and disillusionment. Many Chicanos participated actively in the political life of the nation, during which they took a hard look at their assigned role in the United States, evaluated it, and then decided they had had enough, so they bid goodbye to America. Goodbye America meant not leaving the soil, but denying the legitimacy of the name, recognizing that America was a European term of occupation and colonization. Goodbye America signaled resistance against the integration, oppression, captivity. The cry of Goodbye America also represented an assertion of political power for Chicanos, akin to the cry of Black Power. The careers of the era's two best-known Mexican-American leaders, Cesar Chavez and Corky Gonzalez, revealed this basic drive toward cultural nationalism. Chavez first arrived on the national scene in 1965 when 1,300 Filipino immigrant grape pickers, members of Larry Itilong's Agricultural Workers Organizing Committee, walked out of California vineyards demanding recognition for their union, fair wages, and improved working conditions. As they had in the past, the growers sought replacements, this time attempting to hire local Mexican Americans to break the strike. Itilong asked Chavez to persuade the members of his own fledgling farm workers union, the United Farm Workers Organizing Committee, to honor his picket lines. They did, and the Great Delano Grape Strike began. Born near Yuma, Arizona in 1927, Chavez grew up as a migrant farm worker. He attended more than 30 different schools, eventually reaching the seventh grade, as his family followed the crops across the Southwest. After service in the U.S. Navy, Chavez landed in Delano in 1962 and concentrated on forming the Farm Labor Organization that eventually became known as the UFWOC. Chavez skillfully exploited the grape strike, transforming it from a mundane struggle for better wages and working conditions into a vehicle for dramatizing the plight of migrant farm workers in general and rural Americans, Mexicans, and Mexican-Americans in particular. Borrowing techniques from the civil rights movement, Chavez mounted a series of direct action protests, including the famous grape boycott. Drawing on Mexican-American traditions, he ran the UFWOC more like a mutualista, a 19th-century Mexican cooperative association, than a simple union. The UFWOC established a death benefit plan, a cooperative grocery, a theater group, and a Spanish-language newspaper. Chavez also invoked religious traditions, particularly the symbol of the Virgin of Guadalupe, ingeniously deflecting accusations that his union was somehow communist. In 1970, the Delano grape strike was settled, and the UFWOC embraced a broader cultural nationalist program, an example of community building and Chicano activism in rural areas. But by the 1970s, the Mexican-American experience had become mostly urban, and it was in cities that Chicano nationalism would flourish. The founding figure was Rodolfo Corky Gonzalez, a one-time boxer and Democratic Party operative who became disillusioned with conventional reform politics. In 1966, Gonzalez formed the Crusade for Justice in Denver, an organization devoted to the reform of the police and courts, better housing, more economic opportunity, and significantly relevant education for Chicanos. The crusade became strongly nationalistic. At one point, Gonzalez considered appealing to the United Nations for a plebiscite in the Southwest to determine whether the people, la raza, might desire independence from the United States. Gradually, Gonzalez came to stress culture. During a Denver teacher strike, crusade volunteers stepped in to teach basic subjects like science and math, but also offered courses in Chicano history, Spanish, and Mexican culture. A similar program continued after the strike ended. Crusade for Justice promulgated a plan of the barrio, demanding housing that would meet Chicano cultural needs, education in Spanish, and barrio-owned businesses. Gonzalez also founded the annual Chicano Youth Liberation Conferences, energizing young activists on college campuses. The 1970s and 80s witnessed a broad acceptance of this cultural nationalist agenda throughout Mexican-American politics. In the drive for ethnic studies programs on college campuses, for bilingual education in the public schools, for community control, critiques of integration and assimilation became de rigueur, dissenting voices portraying Mexican-Americans as the latest in a series of immigrant success stories met scorn and derision. And I'm going to stop there because now it's going to go on to explain how the American Indians began organizing and doing their own anti-assimilationist, creating their own anti-assimilationist agenda. But this is part of the reason I'm doing this is today what we're facing with all of the violence and whatnot, it looks like the country's on fire, that everything is chaotic and out of control. I grew up during the 60s, and the 60s was much, much worse. And as this demonstrates, it wasn't just black people that were being militant, if you will. There was Chicanos and American Indians and others. So it seemed like every day in the newspaper there was more stories about whether it's blacks protesting or Chicanos protesting, et cetera, et cetera. This type of thing was going on each and every day, day after day, year after year. So again, this may seem very chaotic today, but it's not nearly as chaotic as things were in the 60s and 70s. The other thing I want to mention about BLM is the whole BLM movement is a black-white movement. BLM fails to recognize that there's anybody else in the United States of America other than blacks and whites. They fail to recognize Mexican-Americans, Central Americans. They fail to recognize Asian Americans, Koreans, Japanese, Chinese, people from India, Pakistan. This is a much more integrated, because whether these groups liked it or not, the United Farm Workers, etc., whether they like it or not, America is becoming more integrationist, period. People are moving in, they're living next to each other. Indians are living next to Hispanics, who are living with blacks, who are living with whites, and we're all mixing. Whether they like it or not, or want it or not, we're becoming more integrated. And there are more and more different ethnicities and nationalities moving into this country each and every day. And BLM's movement, whatever, you know, however you care to define it, is doomed to failure because it simply fails to acknowledge reality. And the reality of today is that, number one, is that this country is much more diverse than it used to be and much more assimilated and integrated than it used to be. And the fact that blacks have made tremendous strides over the past 50 years, that some of the most powerful people, not only in the country, but in the entire world, are American blacks. They own communications companies. They advise presidents. And on and on and on and on. And BLM fails to take this into consideration. They act as though nothing has changed in the past 50 years. And that is simply, it's delusional. There's no other way to put it. So, back in a minute. Who's the true conservative? He's the person that has the courage of his convictions and is confident in what he knows. He's the person that understands that cultural conservatism is more important than political conservatism. He's not selfish, but minds his own business. He acts like an adult. He's patriotic and uses common sense. He expresses what he knows and does so with certainty. He makes judgments, refuses to speculate, speaks clearly and definitively, and is not afraid to say no. He's open-minded, asking why rather than why not. He is consistent, credible, and influential, not ashamed of his existence, unafraid to learn or correct his mistakes. He is a normal American and is better than the socialist. He's a better friend, father, brother, family member, and a better person, period. You have to know that. If you don't know with every fiber of your being that being a true conservative is best, then you're wasting your time. And that brings me to the end of another episode of The Drill. Remember, be honest, be smart, be beautiful, and always ask yourself, what is real? How do I know? What do I do about it? I'm Ron, and that's The Drill.